Some of you perhaps are wondering how I was led into this ministry, into this emphasis in my ministry, back in the early 70s, late 60s. It was really the sovereign working of God. I've always had a practice in my pastorate, where I've been privileged to shepherd, of setting aside two or three mornings each week when I would go to the church very early in the morning. Pastors can do that. When no one else is there, and I would just walk in the sanctuary, blocking out a period of time when I just would stay with the Lord and talk to Him. And that's been one of the truly great experiences of my life. And God has taught me so much in those times about Himself. But in those shut-away times, I would have a different theme that I would focus upon. Revival is a theme that God has assigned to me since my very young days in ministry. I never quite understood why, but it's been like a fire in my bosom, knowing that somehow God, before the trumpet sounds and our Savior returns, that He wants to refresh the church all over the world with a great movement of His grace. I was walking and praying while I still pastored in Colorado, in the church, an auditorium much like this one. And I can remember walking down the aisle, and I just started across the back where we came in from this side. And I was having great liberty to pray about revival when all of a sudden there was this tremendous awareness from my Lord that before a revival like I was asking Him to bring could happen, there would have to be a strong encounter with Satan. I was so shocked. I didn't know what that meant. In fact, it frightened me a little. And so I just walked and wondered what that meant. I didn't pray anymore. Well, the Lord was in process of moving me from that church where I had pastored for 12 years to a new ministry in Oak Park, Illinois. And after I arrived on that field, I started this practice again. And I'd almost forgotten that experience. But once again, I was walking in that church. And I can remember the identical spot again where I was, pouring out my heart for revival, sensing tremendous liberty. And I knew it wasn't Mark Bubeck praying. The Spirit of God had touched my lips with an articulation and a pouring out of my heart to the Lord in a way that I knew only the Spirit of God could do. When all of a sudden the same thing happened. There was this tremendous awareness that just flooded me from the Lord that before a revival like I was asking Him to bring, there would have to be a strong encounter with Satan. And this time I walked and I said, Lord, I don't know anything about that. I'd been through Bible college. I'd been through seminary. I had pastored for some 15 years. I'd preached through the New Testament. But I didn't know anything about that. And so I said, Lord, if you have somebody to teach me, I'm ready to learn. The first thing He did was just take me to the New Testament. And I started to read from Matthew through Revelation. And I had my marker pen. And every time I would come to a passage that had anything to say about the battle that Christians face, at that time I thought it was all going to be with Satan. But then I realized that the Bible clearly sets forth, we don't just have one enemy. We have three enemies that are set forth in the Scripture. We have an internal enemy that's a part of our very person. We call it a sinful nature, a fleshly nature. The Scripture refers to it after we become Christians. And I believe that's the strongest enemy we have. And if we're not making it there, we're going to be in trouble with both the other enemies. The second enemy that's very potent is the world in which we live. A polluted environment. I wish it were only with chemicals and smoke and things like that. But it's a world that's filled with sin and wickedness and evil of every description. We have an internal enemy, we have an external enemy, and we have an infernal enemy. Supernatural evil. Powerful. We don't see this enemy. At least we don't usually see him. People are seeing more and more apparitions. That's one of the problems you run into when a culture gets very wicked, especially in satanic wickedness. You'd be amazed at how many people, I would dare say, if we'd ask you, how many of you have seen something that you thought was a dark presence or something else, you'd be amazed how many people have encountered that sort of thing. It's a very real kingdom. It's not a kingdom we should fear. It's a kingdom we should know about and understand. But if you're a child of God, if you're a Christian, you don't need to be afraid. That's one of the beautiful things God taught me. And I want, in this time that we'll share together, to somehow communicate that. That we have all that we need to be more than conquerors through Him that loved us. I'd like for you to turn, please, to the book of James. We're going to cover quite a bit of material tonight, so I'm going to have to keep moving. The book of James, wonderful book, probably the earliest of all of the New Testament books. Most Bible scholars agree that it was the very first of the recorded scripture, divinely inspired, breathed by the Holy Spirit through the Apostle James, the first pastor of the church at Jerusalem. And I want you to look with me at these three enemies. First of all, let's start in the third chapter, beginning with verse 13, where I'm reading from the New International Version. And if you have another translation, I'm sure you will be able to follow along. Who is wise and understanding among you? James 3, verse 13. Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom, notice it's in quotes, does not come down from heaven. It's not of God. It's not spiritual wisdom. But is earthly, of the world, unspiritual. It's of the flesh, of the devil. See your three enemies? For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. That's the kind of wisdom we need. Then he introduces these three enemies, and I believe he puts them in the order in which we have to look at them. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Have any problems that way? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? Internal enemy. You want something but don't get it. You kill and covet, but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. Even your prayer life is flowing out of your flesh. When you pray, you can be greedy and self-centered because of an internal enemy we have to deal with. We also have the external enemy. Notice how he puts it in verse 4. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Why that strong? Listen to it. The world system is the enemy of God. And if you love it, you have hatred toward God. Anyone who chooses to be the friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think the scripture says without reason that the spirit he caused to live in us envies intensely, but he gives us more grace? That's why scripture says God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So here we have this internal enemy and now the external enemy. But James was concerned about another enemy. And that's supernatural evil. Notice how he puts it, beginning with verse 7. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Now, have you noticed something? When James introduces the infernal enemy, supernatural evil, his focus is not on the devil, but the believer's relationship to the Lord. And he says that we are to submit ourselves to God, we're to come near to God, and he will come near to us, then we're to make sure that we're dealing with sin. And I want you to know the strength of it. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. I started out by saying God's people are the only ones who have a right to laugh in a world that's in the mess ours is in. But when we have unresolved sin in our own lives, when we are not walking in our freedom and our victory over our flesh and over the world system and all of its power to press us into its mold, and over the devil who today is coming with a boldness against us like no time perhaps in history. That's the time when our laughter needs to be turned to mourning and grieving and humbling our hearts before God. That's what we need today, friends. Revival is in the wind, but it'll never come until, first of all, God begins to get a hold of some people who know Him and love Him and begin to deal with the sin in their own lives and the defeat that doesn't belong to them. We are to walk in freedom from the rule of our flesh, from the rule of Satan, and from the rule of the world. Well, that's what we're going to look at. And let me just put this up quickly on the overhead. Often say there are three important words to keep in mind in this whole subject of spiritual warfare. The first one is the word balance. And the second one is the word balance. And the third one is the word balance. Because it's so easy for us to begin to do one of two things. Either to sort of dismiss the devil and his kingdom as something that's not too important and we shouldn't be really talking about it too much. Let's just preach the gospel and get people saved and forget about the battle that's been around since the Garden of Eden. You see, we've almost lost our biblical worldview. At least that's what happened in my humble judgment. To God's people, whether you're Mennonites or Presbyterians or Lutherans or Baptists or whoever we were, we became so westernized, so brainwashed by the age of the Enlightenment, so-called. I've often said we should have called it the Endarkenment. Kant and Nietzsche and those philosophers that sort of set the stage for the Western culture and the Western educational system and had a tremendous impact even upon biblical theology. Of course, we know the whole liberal movement came out of that. But this is a day in which God's people are being forced back to a biblical worldview. And we do not want to become Satan-centered. And balance, as I'm going to be sharing with you, involves, first of all, a biblical understanding of yourself. If you don't know who you are, you're not going very far. So we need to have an understanding of who we are, a biblical evaluation. And especially of our flesh, so we know what we're up against. And we'll begin to look at that tomorrow. But we also must have an appreciation of the world. And certainly an appreciation of the kingdom of darkness and what we're up against. So that's one thing that we need to be careful of, that we don't underestimate his considerable power. But the other side of the picture is we must not overestimate his considerable power. And I find this is one of the major problems with most of us when it comes to any kind of biblical study on spiritual warfare and talk about the devil and Satan. We're afraid. I mentioned to you that when I was first led into this, that a feeling of fear came on me. And I found that when I started to ask my pastor friends, I heard the strangest things. Excuse me. I heard things like, I never preach on the devil, because when I do, I find myself always getting hit so hard. And so I just don't preach on the devil. Well, that didn't sound like the grace of God to me. It sounded more like the grace of Satan. You don't hit me, you don't talk about me, and I won't hurt you. Well, we're not interested in the grace of Satan. We're interested in God's grace. Excuse me. Could someone maybe get me a glass of water? I've got a tickle in my throat. One of you, maybe in the back, who knows where you could get one. Thank you. But, sometimes we think of God up here. And then over here is Satan. Maybe not quite as high as God. And that's kind of our view. There's righteousness, truth, holiness, justice, the absolutes of God. And over here is evil and murder and violence and wickedness of every description. And we have that view, but it's not that way. There's God way up here. And you can't get as high as he is. You have to leave it up there. And way down here someplace is Satan, who's a created being. And Martin Luther had it very well in his hymn when he said, "One little word will tell him." You know how quickly Satan's going to be thrown into the lake of fire? It'll be so fast. Just the command of God, and you'll be there. So, understand the greatness of God. Even in this battle, we're up against where Satanism and spiritual evil is invading our culture like a plague. From every direction, whether it's New Age or open worship of the devil and sacrificing human sacrifices to the devil, which is increasing in our culture at a phenomenal rate. Anton LaVey made the boast. This was 2 or 3 years ago. One of my friends heard him say it publicly, that over 3,000 human sacrifices had been offered to Satan in America the year before. I don't know whether that's valid or not, but from the reports that keep coming, it could be. It could be. When evil begins to permeate a culture like it is, all of us begin to feel the pressure. You can't live in a culture that's giving itself to evil like our culture, but what you begin to feel, the pressure of it. But God is still God. It's wonderful to know He's got it all in His hand. You know, the only ingredient lacking today in a tremendous move of God in this nation, it's people who are humbling themselves, who know the Lord and seeking His face with all their hearts for bringing revival. My last book, the publisher gave it the title The Satanic Revival, but it's really about spiritual revival. And calling God's people to believe Him for it. And I believe it's coming. But I believe that God has to raise up people right here in your community who will begin to get together in little groups and bigger groups and in your own heart where you just begin to pray. And one of the things that you'll be able to get while you're here is a little prayer booklet that is a part of this Satanic Revival prayers that I put in there. 7 prayers. Revival prayer. And those will be available here sometime tomorrow. Probably don't have enough for everyone, but if God lays it upon your heart to begin to pray, I hope you will. Let me just share with you out of my own experience a wonderful illustration of the almighty power of God to intervene against concentrated worldly evil, spiritual evil, and fleshly evil. We were invited to go to Romania back before Ceausescu fell. Some Christian friends had invited us to come to do some teaching and preaching. We had several doctors in our church that were Christian doctors. And because one of the pastors was a Christian doctor, they just felt that it would be good for these doctors to come and encourage the brothers there in Romania. Well, we learned that they needed some medicine, the Christians. There was a short supply of certain medicines, and some of them were really hurting. So one of the doctors prepared about $2,000 worth of medicine that we had learned they really needed as Christians. And he put it in a large, round carry-on bag. Airline bag, about this high and about this round. He just filled it full. Well, you know, how are we going to get that into Romania? Then on top of it, I felt led of the Lord to put 25 copies of my books. The Adversary and Overcoming the Adversary in my luggage to try to get it in. Now, those aren't the most docile titles to try to get them through those checkpoints. Well, we were traveling through Hungary in a car going toward the border, and we were praying the smuggler's prayer. You probably heard about that from Brother Andrew. Lord, You're the one that made blind eyes see. Now, make seeing eyes blind. And we really prayed that. Well, we got closer to the border, and the more I was concerned, I had put 10 clothing all the way to the bottom, and then I put the other books on the back side of my garment bag in the big pockets there. But when we got to the checkpoint, and they pushed us into this special line. And at that time, it was more difficult to get into that country with anything than any other country. of the world, really. And so we were in this line, and we were in a steel shed, and I was outside kind of walking, pacing, getting more nervous because we were just having to wait. All I could think about was those books, and maybe this would stop everything if they discovered them, and we'd be disgraced and have to leave and wouldn't even be able to go in. And all of a sudden I heard up in the rafters a cooing dove. And I looked up there, and it was a very large species of dove, just cooing away. And all of a sudden I remembered how the Holy Spirit came upon the Lord Jesus. And somehow I just relaxed. Well, about that moment, this inspector came. He told us to take all our luggage out. We had to put them on these steel enforced cement tables. And we were to stand by it until he had inspected it. And then we watched as he went to the car. He looked under the hood. He went along the side and he tapped all the doors. Looked under the seats. Even looked under the dash to see if we had something stashed up there. And then he came over. And it was my turn. And he came to my little carry-on case. He dug down on one end, clear to the bottom. Then he dug down on the other end, clear to the bottom. And I thought, oh, good, he's not going to look in the middle. But just at that moment, he took his hands. He pushed it down where the clothing was, and he pulled the clothing apart. And I looked, and he looked. And I didn't see any books, and he didn't see any books. I said, where did I put those books? Then he went to my garment bag. He looked inside the garment bag. He even looked in my suit pockets in the garment bag to see if I had anything in these pockets. But he never looked in the pockets on the other side. He said, put it back in the car. Well, I was so excited. I didn't know what had happened, but I knew something marvelous had happened. And so I kind of missed what happened to the doctor who was right next to me. He went over and he looked through his case. He looked through his garment bag just as thoroughly as he had looked through mine. But he had placed the medicine that was for the Christians on the ground right by the table. He had opened it up and all the bottles were showing. You know, that inspector never saw that. There's no way to explain that. Except, you know what I think happened? I think an angel was there. And he just kind of shielded that. He told him to put it back in the car. And the reason we know it's so serious, that the last doctor, he had a suitcase full of medicine. They took it away from us. They wouldn't even let us take it into the city to give it to the hospital. We were so excited when we drove into the city that day. I couldn't wait to get to the hotel. I opened up my suitcase. I pulled those clothes apart. There were my books. Now, I can't explain that, friends. But that's who our God is. When God determines to do something, He doesn't. No matter who's against Him. Let me share another illustration quickly with you. And then I want to go to another study. When we had our conference in Sioux City last year, we had two German fellows come. One was the father and the other was a son. And the older man's father had been an SS trooper. And he had been a Satanist, as many of the Nazis were. But God reached through all of that and saved him. And now the Lord is using him in a marvelous way to free up people who've been a part of Satanism. And I don't have time to go into all that, except it was my privilege this last September to visit them in their ministry in Germany and see what they're doing. And it's a marvelous thing. But let me tell you about one young woman. They had her here in this country, in fact, because of some of the need to protect her from the Satanists. She had been chosen for a very high position in the World Satanist Organization. She had come from a long line of Satanists. Her parents had been Satanists. Her grandparents on both sides had been Satanists. And so, in the spirit realm, they had chosen her. Evil spirits had chosen her. That's who they put in power in that movement. They get their messages from the realm of darkness. And she was a part of this hierarchy that is even now meeting in a worldwide organization to try to foster the program of Satan. But they assigned her to go to this evangelical church in Germany. It wasn't a very big church. But she was to infiltrate that church and work against what God might be doing there. But what the Satanists hadn't counted on is that this girl was hurting. That's usually the thing that brings people out of Satanism. They hurt. And so she began to look for answers, and some Christian in that congregation began to just love her and reach out to her. And as a young woman, she became a Christian believer, born of God. But when that happens, it's a terrible insult to the kingdom of darkness. And they do not want to let them go. And they began to concentrate all of their power efforts against her. And that's when the Gerlachs came into the situation. They took her into their home and they protected her. But, and there's some amazing stories about how they tried to come and get her. But they couldn't get her. But one night, she disappeared. And they didn't know where she had gone. But Horst went out and he showed me this place in the forest where he walks and prays. And he was walking and praying, and he said, "Lord, you know that they've taken." And he called her by name. And we don't know where she's at. But you know where she's at. And if you want us to rescue her, I believe you can put into my mind, even as I pray, where she is. And all of a sudden, as he was walking and praying, into his mind came a certain hotel in Amsterdam, Holland, over 200 miles away. He didn't even know if there was a hotel by that name in Amsterdam. But when he went and told his wife and his wife said, "Horst, you must go." And so he went, and sure enough, there was a hotel by that name. And so he drove to it, and he got out of his car, and he just decided he'd go in. And he started to go in the door. And it was just like the Holy Spirit wouldn't let him go in. And so he had to He decided he better just walk around it and pray. And he started to walk around. He got to the corner of the hotel to turn to go up the side street. When all of a sudden, this young woman rushed into his presence. And the trance that she was in was broken when she saw him. And she knew that she was coming to a World Satanist meeting. He rushed her to his car and they got in. And they were just ready to drive away when the Holy Spirit reminded Horace that he had assigned him to rebuke this kind of thing. And so he drove back to that hotel. And he drove right up in front. And he was just about to get out when all of a sudden he was surrounded by black-robed Satanists from all over the world who had gathered there. A car pulled up against his back bumper. Another backed up against his front bumper. And the leader of the World Satanist Organization, who happens to be a man in California, stood opposite his driver's window in all of his dark, hideous paraphernalia, and he looked at him through the window with the glower of hell on his face. And he said, "She belongs to us. You must release her to us or you will never leave here." He didn't know what to do. But all of a sudden the Lord just gave him courage and he rolled down the window. On the driver's side, he turned and looked at that black-robed world leader of Satanism, and he simply said, "Jesus Christ is the conqueror of Satan. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is the conqueror of Satan." And he said it three times, and every time he said it, it was just like invisible power of God just pushed him back. And a stunned look was upon his face. And he was helpless. And Horace looked. And the car in front of him was no longer there. He doesn't know what happened. He thinks the angels moved him. So he just started to drive. With his arms circling as he drove. Shouting, "Jesus Christ is the conqueror of Satan. Jesus Christ is Lord." And he drove away. And they couldn't touch him. Now that may seem like a rather dramatic, sensational story. But I know the veracity of that. And it's just another wonderful evidence that the message of this book is an absolutely trustworthy message. I want to take you now quickly to the book of Psalms, chapter 91, and leave you with an outline that I think will fill you with a lot of blessing. This psalm has become a rich, rich treasure to me. This is a psalm that I pray back to God almost every day that I live. And I would like to suggest that everyone memorize it. I usually quote it at this point, but in the interest of time, I'll not do that, because we're going to read every verse anyway. But I want you to note the victory of this psalm. The Old Testament psalmist had an appreciation for the absolute victory of the believer who unites himself with his Lord over any and all opposition that Satan and all the host of hell might try to put against God's people. Look at it. He says, he who dwells. Now that word dwells means abides in the New Testament sense. In the shelter of the Most High. That's the Hebrew word Elyon. It's one of God's names. It's a superlative word. It means the highest of all the high. When you put all of your hope and trust in the highest of all of the high, and by the way, you can't measure that. You just have to kind of stop and say, higher than that, when you think to the limits of your ability to think about highness. God, the Almighty, Elyon, is higher than all the high. And if you make Him your dwelling, if you abide in the shelter, the provided protection. Now keep in mind, dear friends, this is not saying for everyone. This is talking about those people who walk in their freedom. Those Christians who are serious about walking in their freedom over their flesh and the world and Satan. Those who dwell. We'll look in a few moments at who those are. We'll rest in the shadow of the Almighty. Here's another name for God. Many of us know that word, Shaddai. He's the mightiest of all the mighty. And if you're dwelling in the shelter of Elyon, the highest of the high, then you'll be resting and at peace in the shadow of Shaddai, the mightiest of the mighty. You know, if you're in somebody's shadow, you know he's very close to you. I can remember the days when my daughters were very young, and we used to take our vacations, and sometimes we'd go to the beautiful places in Colorado and Wyoming, and here in Montana, down around Yellowstone, and they just loved to do that. But sometimes we'd get in high places, and sometimes it was a little scary for little girls. And I can remember how my two older girls, when they were real little, one had to get a hold of this leg and the other one to get a hold of the other leg. And when Dad was there, they weren't afraid. Even in scary places. And I can remember people saying, who are your little shadows? They were close. And that's what this is talking about. That God gets close to you. And this is Shaddai, the mightiest of the mighty. Then he says, I will say of the Lord, that's Jehovah, his personal name. He is my refuge and my fortress. He's my safety, my hiding place, my God, my Elohim. That's a singular plural. And many Bible students see the Old Testament word for God, Elohim, a singular plural word, as a word that points us to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. But isn't that a beautiful picture? Elyon, Shaddai, Jehovah, Elohim, being your protection. Now notice what he says. And those of you with a rural background will love this. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare, that's Satan, and from the deadly pestilence. Satan has a deadly purpose against you. Then here's where it gets beautiful. He will cover you with his feathers. And under his wings you will find refuge. Now that's a picture out of nature again of an old mother hen. And some of you know all about that. I used to love that on the farm when I was a boy. When an old setting hen, usually they would have a little nest they'd put someplace and nobody knew where it was. And that she was setting on the eggs, and then one day she'd come strutting out with this little brood that she'd hatched. Maybe a dozen chicks. And the thing that always fascinated me was when any danger would threaten, she had a certain cluck. And those little chicks knew that cluck. And they'd run to her, and they'd disappear under her feathers. She'd fluff them. But the thing I remember the most was the fierceness of that mother protection of that little brood. In fact, I used to love to just take my dog and just kind of, you know, get close. And I can remember my dog, he wasn't afraid of anything. But that old hen, he was afraid of her. Somehow he knew that rage of protective care of that old mother hen was something he didn't dare come up against. And he'd cower away. Now keep in mind, the picture is beautiful, but this is not a mother hen. This is Elyon. This is Shaddai. And he's put you, when you dwell in his shelter, under his feathers and his wings, and woe be to the enemy that tries to harm you. And notice what he says. His faithfulness will be your shield, your protection, and your rampart, your hiding place. You will not fear the terror of night. That's the way Satan often tries to get at us. In terror of night and fear. It's amazing how many people that get in trouble with Satan have horrible dreams. And fill them with fear and terror. He comes when we're passive in sleep. If we're not protecting ourselves, fills us with terror. But you'll notice that when you've made Elyon your dwelling place, and you're resting in the shadow of the Almighty, that doesn't happen. You don't have to be afraid, nor the arrow that flies by day. He doesn't just come at you at night. He comes at you all day long. We have so many people coming to us now in our counseling center, and they tell about these voices they're hearing that are telling them to curse God and all kinds of wicked things coming into their mind. It's coming from the enemy. He's coming with his arrows that fly by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. See, it's a picture of a fierce opponent, the fowler, who wants to hurt you, who wants to fill you with fear and terror and arrows and everything he can do to harm you. And then you'll notice what he says. 1,000 may fall at your side. And dear friends, this is what's happening today. All around us, they're falling. Victims of Satan. It's astonishing. The television, the movies are filled with fear themes, violent themes, satanic things, demonic things. People are experimenting with witchcraft and sorcery and curses. and they're falling 10,000 at your right hand. But it will not come near you. You don't need to fall victim to him. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. And that's happening too. The AIDS epidemic, and so much that's happening to show the awful results of wickedness all over the world. Now this is where it really gets precious. And you dads ought to listen to this. If you... Now here's the testimony of the psalmist. And tradition says this is a psalm of Moses. We really don't know for sure, but I think it probably is. And notice what he says. If you make Elyon, the highest of the high, the one of whom there's no one higher, your dwelling, even the Lord, Jehovah, who's my refuge, then no harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent. You know what I think he was thinking about? When they came out of Egypt and the death angel came, and where the blood was on the doorposts, the death angel couldn't stop there because there was other protection there. Elyon's protection. Jehovah's protection. And I love the way he says it. No harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent. I watch over my tent very carefully. That's one of the reasons I quote this psalm. I know Satan would like to kill me. I've heard that so many times I couldn't enumerate it from the lips of people who've been controlled by wicked spirits. They were going to kill me. Going to kill my wife, going to kill my children. They haven't touched them yet, and they won't. Not because I'm presumptuous, but because I'm aggressively claiming what God told me belonged to me. Now, this is where it gets precious. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. Isn't that great? Reminds me of that Old Testament scene where Elisha knew he was protected when all the enemy of the Syrians had come against him. And his attendant was so frightened. God said, let him see, or Elisha said, let him see the protection. All of a sudden, God drew aside that curtain that separates the eternal and the spirit realm from human eyes, and he saw the whole heavens filled with the armies of heaven. They're here tonight. Did you know that? I asked them to be here. I ask the Lord to not to allow even one wicked spirit in this place tonight. That if anybody was troubled with wicked spirits, that at least they could hear in this building tonight that there's hope and there's freedom in Jesus Christ. Angels are wonderful. And they're powerful. And they're protecting. Notice he says they will lift you up in their hands so that you don't strike your foot against the stone. The most incidental, things I'm going to give you this all at once here. are of interest to angels concerning you. Now you remember that Satan quoted this when he tempted Christ, and it certainly applied to the Lord Jesus. But notice, he says, you will tread upon the lion and the cobra. That's Satan. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. You see, ours is not just a protective victory when we're walking in the shelter of the Most High and in the shadow of Shaddai. We walk all over the kingdom of darkness in triumph and victory. That's why if God's people could once catch a vision again of who they are, we could shake this old nation mightily for God. Now, I'd never seen this before until just this last week. The closing part of it is God's